From the Pensado Media Center, powered by Westlake Pro.
Going to celebrate one of the all-time innovators in music and recording, our learned guest has all the inside info. Special heads up to folks in the UK. Some evidence that audio is king at South by Southwest. We'll talk about that. A new ITL from our Groove 3 series and news you can use. Let's get it. JD, fire it up. You're at the place. It's Pensado's place.
Yay.
A lot going on, as we always say. Glad you came by. I'm particularly excited about today and today's show. Herbert, what's up?
I feel the same way. This came to us.
I'm sorry, you don't like being called Herbert, do you?
No, it's fine. Okay. By you, it's okay.
I forget sometimes. I just like saying that.
Anybody in my family, it's a fist fight. but this came to us at NAMM, this particular guest. Yeah. And it was interesting to go into his history and see just how wide and varied it is and how much information he has.
So 100%. That's a good one.
Great author. You've been busy, man. A lot going on in your life. Fab Factory stuff, all kinds of good stuff coming, correct?
Yeah, I don't know if it's busy. Like we got a saying back home, when you got too much to do, do nothing.
Okay. Oh, you're the master of that.
Yeah. And if you don't know what you're doing, just do it real fast.
Okay, good. So how do you do nothing really fast?
Well, that's the conundrum.
Okay, got you. So we'll work that out. Yeah. Right. There's probably some software plug-in
for
that.
Well, the main thing you do when that happens is just dial 818.
And call me.
Call you.
Okay, got it. And then I can do nothing from a management standpoint. Shall we get to it?
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's do it. Hey guys, how was your week? We hope it was outstanding. Thanks in advance for those likes and subscribes. Those things continue. And Chongor, what are we up to in terms of likes and subscribes, ballpark?
About 80,000 on Facebook, coming up to 150 on YouTube, so
doing
really good.
Yep. Wow, I had no idea.
Who are these people?
People who like us. Be nice to them.
Like I said, who are these people?
People we love.
We love them.
That's amazing.
I want all of them to show up at the next live event.
Me too, so we can meet every one of them. Absolutely.
I want to be able to say, Larry, how's the kids?
Absolutely.
Bill, did you master that 3K on your vocal yet?
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you guys come to our next live event, we'll let you know. But being serious, thank you so much for that. You have no idea how important that is to the show. So we thank you for that. Also want to thank our partners. They have kept this show free for you for over 250 episodes. They are absolutely amazing. You know them. The Blackbird Academy, Vintage King, Audio Technica, Isotope, Aftermaster, Fab Factory, Recording Connection, and Avid. Phenomenal, each and every one of them. And please support them as they support us. In national news, Dave and I are at the Blackbird Academy on May 13th. Sign up for their April class post-haste. Also, July class is open as well. Veterans, we celebrate your service.
For sure.
They are VA approved. They will hook you up. International students, come on over. They are ready for you as well. Folks coming from South Africa, France, Canada, and a whole lot more. You want to hit karma at theblackbirdacademy.com. You'll be glad you did it. I know we overemphasize this all the time. Nashville's a special town. That's a special school. You'll get special training, and you will be glad you did it.
And it's not just country music either.
No, it's every genre.
Paramore works there. Kings of Leon.
Absolutely.
Jack White.
Absolutely.
It's just a great place if you enjoy live music.
I think the first year we went down, one of the engineers told me they had cut something like 60 rap records. Mm-hmm. There, so I mean, it's just a music city. It really is,
and it's a great vacation spot.
On top of it, great town, great foodie town. Hattie's hot chicken. Trust us when we tell you.
Did you notice that Kentucky Fried Chicken has Nashville chicken now?
Don't do it.
I haven't tried it.
Okay, cool. Don't
I'm not gonna try it.
Just go to Nashville. Go to Nashville. Call Dave. We'll put on his credit card. Go down and have hot chicken. Don't worry about it. I'll give you the number. I've been receiving a lot of calls, both Dave and I, from all the folks at South by Southwest. There are more panels on audio, new applications for audio, audio utilized in other media platforms, technology advances in sound, and on and on and on. It is a good time to be making your career in our fine art of audio. And I got to tell you, when you hear from folks in that concentrated place, audio runs very wide and very deep. So, you know, good place to be.
Austin's just a musical town.
Absolutely. Good. Well, you know what, from a technology standpoint, like from NAMM to now, you know, we get hit with a lot of different things. One of the things that you had a reaction to was Audionamics, because you did something at their booth. Give me the cliff notes on what you liked about that.
Well, they have a standalone version and a plug-in version. I like the standalone version. There's a lot of people that have tried to do a similar thing where you could remove like a lead vocal from a song, or you could remove a guitar solo or sax solo. And there's a lot of really good ones, but this one gets it. It's really good. I first started using something similar to this, but I'm using this now because it's better. When I was learning how to engineer, I would take the vocal out of a song with a piece of gear called the Thompson Vocal Eliminator, and it left all the vocal effects just by themselves, so I could hear them and copy them and learn. So that's a great technique and a learning technique. It's good for live sound, incredible for post-production, film, remixers can get vocals, and it's affordable. And the company is something you can support. Great.
Can you use
company.
It like in sampling and other stuff? Does the application work there?
We don't broadcast that, but
but it does work.
We don't want everybody that buys a copy to be checked by by ISIS or something.
Right, right.
Just to be clear, I sample every damn thing.
There you go.
If I hear a sound on a record I like, I sample it. But let me stop you real quick.
Sure.
The weirdest thing is, and if you guys have done this before, you know this to be true, you can sample a kick drum off a record that you think is the greatest kick drum ever. You put it in your song, it sounds like crap.
Right.
It's like, I wonder why that is.
Well, so the thing that I noticed, because I know you pretty well, is that you don't react to things unless you see the way you can use them and how good it is. I remember you called me right afterwards and said, this thing is so good, I'm not quite, there's just so many different applications, I got to think about it for a while, which is very rare.
Yeah.
Which is really rare for you. Wasn't there like an article or something recently on them? Somebody covered them.
Yeah, Kevin Becker, our buddy.
Oh, Mix Magazine?
Mix Magazine, yeah.
Oh, cool. Yeah. So there's a lot of information in that, you think?
Yeah, I think you should check it out because it gives you an overview, real good overview. You know, Kevin's teacher, so.
No question. Wait till they see what Kevin's coming with.
Oh,
okay,
really?
Yeah, the Blackbird Foundational Series. That's a whole other thing. Wow. Good stuff. Good people at Audionamics.
Yeah.
Matchek, our boy Scott Peterson.
Yeah, Scott.
Rick, who is a very bright guy and a guy really behind it. And then, of course, Miss Talisha, Miss T, as we call her, right?
Yeah.
That's our girl. But it's a great team.
Smart people.
Yeah, and so we're going to bring some ITLs and stuff about them in the future. Good stuff?
Great stuff.
Good stuff. Quick shout out to another really, really fine learning institution, which is Berkeley in Boston. I had a great hang the other day with Peter Gordon, who heads up their Berkeley in LA initiative. Some really interesting things are coming out of this discussion. So kudos to Peter and their plans. I think we're actually having a student group next week or something coming in, about 20 folks from Berkeley. So that's going to be a good stuff. You know what it's time for?
Hold on.
It's time to say hello. Let's say hello to the hapless historian who has not an ounce of hotness. How about that? It's a hapless historian who does not have an ounce of hotness. He goes by the name of
Jumbo.
Damn, that's the first time I really noticed the Timothy role. Has that always been there?
Yeah, it's Bill Myers, man.
Damn, Bill Myers.
I don't even know what to say.
The
I guess I'm a
historian who doesn't have an ounce of hotness. Is
shade there.
We'll ask Natsumi about that.
Yeah,
do you think he's hapless?
No, I'm thinking about last week.
No, I
got that flamed when I called him El Hombre con Hombre. But I thought that was kind of witty.
Apparently it was. Chongor, how are you?
Man, I'm doing so great.
Yeah.
We have another great show with great questions.
And yeah, good questions from the audience.
Really great ones.
Chongor and I have been hanging out all week.
Yeah, I was getting ready to say, you've been doing a lot of work in one of our initiatives with Dave and with people like Al Schmidt and Ed Cherney and all that kind of stuff.
Yep.
Good stuff? You learning a lot?
Really great stuff.
I should probably say, Record Plant was really kind and generous.
Shout outs to them.
For letting us come over there. We had a great time. Thanks for taking care of us. You guys were amazing. The studio's incredible.
Mm-hmm. And that was hooked up by our own Leandro.
No, it's upside down.
Leandro. Hidalgo. So I'll go this way and then that way.
Oh, I like
Say
that.
Ray, let's do it together. Yeah,
sure. Let's do it together.
Leandro Hidalgo.
I have to practice.
Okay, we'll practice that and we'll go from
Try
there.
Left-handed.
Now that the show is completely off the rails, that's all right. So the cool part about Groove 3 is they have these incredible videos that we can utilize as ITLs periodically while we shoot more of ours. This one, this week we come from the series. You and Chongor found something you really like.
Yeah, Isotope came out with a plugin recently called DDLY. Mm-hmm. It's got several sections I truly love. The granular section is what gets explained in this
Tutorial.
Video.
Yeah, oh, cool.
It's really good. Really
Let's
good.
Roll it. Check Isotope. It
In this video, I want to show you more about Isotope's D-Delay dynamic delay plugin. This time I'm going to focus on the granular mode for the delays. The granular mode allows you to create some really interesting effects. Not like traditional delay, it's more like resynthesizing. Now I found that granular mode works best on long sustain type sounds. So I'm going to start with an example of that. So here's the sound. This is just a loop, kind of an interesting pad from my loop library. All right, so I'm starting with that sound. Now, running it through the granular delays, first I want to show you the setup. So the way the granular mode works is when you go into your delay line, you'll get this number of milliseconds of delay. However, it will chop up your sound into grains that are this size. So if we set this to, say, around 100 milliseconds and this is at 4, then it's going to actually chop up the sound. And then as you modulate the delay time, if you're dynamically increasing the delay time, the grains will get spread out, so there'll be gaps between them. As you're shortening the delay time, the grains will overlap. So this causes a variety of interactions, phase interactions. It gives you resynthesis, new pitches, and things like that. You add into that a little feedback, and you can repitch each grain as it goes through the delay. Then you've got a wide variety of things you can do to create some very strange effects. You can also mix that in with the original signal, and it will either interact with the original signal, or if you turn the mix all the way up, it will replace the original signal entirely. So I'm going to start with that all the way up. We'll go with a fairly long delay time, and I'll show you examples of changing this. Now keep in mind, the dynamic aspect of D-delay means that what goes above the line will go to the top delay, and what goes below the line will go to the bottom delay. That means we can have two different setups. We can kind of use this threshold to morph between our two different setups. So that's the kind of thing. You can create these weird alien landscapes. So I'm going to manipulate these controls and kind of show you what I mean. So you hear that kind of glitching effect as I turn this up. If you have an audible size grain size, you can actually hear a chunk that's kind of in this range, somewhere around 40. And then as you turn up the time, you can get a stutter effect. So that's one example of things you can do. Now let's manipulate the bottom delay, and then we'll morph between the two. All right, so that was back to the original signal with it bypassed. But you can see that you can really get creative with these controls, especially if you map these to some knobs. All right, so in the next example, I'm going to use a snare drum and show you how to do some pitch effects using the granular delay along with just a simple snare drum sample. So first I'll bypass so you can hear the raw sample. So starting with a 32nd note, you can see I've got a fair degree of feedback dialed in, but if I want to hear this pitch go up, then I don't want too much pitch. So I'm going to start with pitch just being one. This is one semitone, meaning a half step. And then you can see the grain size. Now, if you mix this in too much, it will actually affect the timing. So you have to be careful that you have some of the original sample coming through. So I'll mix this in and you'll be able to hear this pitch rise effect. As we adjust the pitch knob, then we can have this be more or less dramatic. You can also hear that feedback has a big impact on whether this works or not. And keep in mind, everything going to the top line here is going through the top delay, and everything below this is going to the bottom delay. So we can set up something different on the bottom. And then as we push this up, we'll get more of the bottom. As we push it down, we'll get more of the top. So that shows using this to pitch down. So you can actually do a pitch down. So let's set up something to go on the bottom side of this. So that's an example using a simple snare hit. It gives you the ability to either affect the timing of an individual drum sound like this, or to give the sound of it some sound design characteristics that you might not otherwise come up with. So I want to show you one more example with D-delay and the granular mode. Now on the top, I've automated several of these parameters so that they'll actually be moving around while playing back. Now you can manually do these, or you can use some sort of oscillator, and I've used a combination of those techniques. I've also set up a different granular delay on the bottom that I'm manually changing, and I've also rolled this off because this is an entire loop, as you'll hear. Now, the drums playing in here are not going through the delay. They're just part of the backing track for this example. So first, I'm going to start by bypassing the effects so you can hear what it sounds like before D-delay.
Thank you.
All right, so you see that time is being modulated, the size, the grain size is being modulated, as well as the pitch is sort of jumping around. Now you can play these in and record those kinds of moves, and you can get some really interesting, unpredictable sounds, which means you can actually play like an instrument and really morph whatever loop material you're playing, or even use this as a real-time performance tool. Now, on the bottom, I've got something else. So as I move this up, you'll hear more of the bottom delay. As I move it down, you'll hear more of the top delay. At the very end, you heard it with it bypassed. And that just goes to show you can do dramatic changes. So you can take a lifeless beat, or you could reuse something you've already done in a whole new way, or to give contrast to certain parts of your tune. So I hope you've enjoyed this video on DDLY or D-Delay from iZotope. It's a fun new plugin. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in another video very soon.
Our guest is an incredibly accomplished author. He, all this time spent, he knows where the bodies are buried and all the inside stuff, but if you read his books, they're incredibly entertaining. I mean, 16 books to his credit and more on the way. We are pleased to welcome to our desk the one and the only, Howard Massey. Howard, hey.
Hey, Herb. Howard. Good to see you, man.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Really quickly, one of the things that we try to do on our show is inevitably in life, there's some times where people pass and move on. Mm-hmm. We like to celebrate their accomplishments.
Of course.
So one of the things, that, one of the great innovators in our business and certainly left his mark, and you knew him and you've watched him and emulated him, is George Martin, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Tell us,
yeah.
Give us your observations of George and his contributions.
Well, I think George's contributions as a producer are obvious. Mm-hmm. I mean, all you have to do is listen to any Beatles record mm-hmm. and know how he changed the whole face of music forever. But people that knew him personally, and I can't say we were close friends, I met him several times, mm-hmm. but everybody who knew him personally will use the same word in describing him. He was a gentleman.
Mm,
above so everything, true. He was a gentleman.
Oh, really?
Very kind, gentle, generous soul.
He did a foreword in one of your books.
He wrote the foreword to the Great British Recording Studios,
wow.
for which I'm forever indebted.
How honored were you about that?
I was blown away, to be honest with you.
See, the thing that blew me away is when I read about him, and I guess I didn't realize it while he was alive, which is crazy, is there were just so many innovative sound things he did, you know, making the tape go backwards and doing stuff that at the time was just groundbreaking, mm-hmm. sounds and stuff that when you... Right? I didn't realize
100%.
He did all that.
I mean, those records from the 50s and 60s, his records were in the 60s, the technology was still very new.
Right.
And it was hard to just get it to work, much less work in unique ways.
Right.
And there's a special group of people that came out of England, along with Putnam Jr. here, mm-hmm. A couple other guys here, that we stand on their shoulders. Mm. There's no other way to say it. They showed us techniques and possibilities is the way to say it,
well,
I guess.
The thing that fascinated me was when the technology isn't there, you have to sort of imagine it mm. and then figure out how to do it, right?
Like, yes, totally.
Those are two parts of the chain.
As you're going along.
Yeah,
you
make I mean, it up. That's...
A lot of people know synthesizers. There's two ways to use a synthesizer. Start from scratch or mm-hmm. use presets.
Right.
And engineering's the same way. There's a lot of metaphorical presets available to us.
Right.
But those guys just did it from scratch.
That's
there were
amazing.
No presets back
George,
then.
George had a very unique background. He was classically trained.
Uh-huh.
He'd done a lot of work with comedy teams, so he was really into sound effects. He,
really?
He worked with Peter Sellers and the Goons.
Are you kidding?
And he also had a lot of involvement in music concrete, which
really?
Is where he learned about backwards tape techniques.
Uh-huh.
So much of the Beatles' success was down to their talent, clearly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I'm always amazed at how much of their success was down to serendipity. John Lennon and Paul McCartney grew up within 10 miles of each other, within a year and a half of each other.
Wow.
what was the odds of the two greatest songwriters of the 20th century
being in the same neighborhood.
And then they crossed paths with George Martin, who was the perfect producer for them with that level of ability that they, it wasn't part of their musical vocabulary at the time. They were rock and rollers.
Right.
He knew classical music, he knew vocal arrangements, he knew sound effects, and it was just the perfect marriage.
What made you, beyond incredible talent like Bill Putnam Jr. and George Martin, and so the genesis behind the British, the British studios, where would the idea come from? Tell us about that journey.
Well, I mean, there had been live recording in Britain since the pretty much the turn of the 20th century. But Abbey Road was the first permanent installation. It was the first studio. At the time, it was called EMI. It was owned by EMI Records.
EMI Thorn, wasn't it?
EMI Thorn, exactly. And the recording studio was just a little tiny part of this huge company. You know, they specialize in radio and radar and all of these other technologies. They opened the first major recording studio in Britain in 1931.
Wow.
Which is pretty astonishing if you think back to that.
Yeah. And there was other stuff going on back then.
Exactly. And for 25 years, they were pretty much the only major recording studio. It wasn't until the mid-50s that other studios began sprouting up in England. There were other record labels, but they were doing remote recording. They were sending out trucks loaded with equipment to record mostly classical orchestras in concert halls.
It feels to me like if there were no BBC, there'd be no Neve, because they bought everything Neve made. But. The BBC had some recording, audio recording facilities at the time too, didn't they?
They did.
Didn't a lot of those engineers migrate over to Abbey Road?
No, engineers did not migrate. It wasn't until the mid-60s, even the late-60s, that engineers began moving around. It was a little bit like Japan in those days. When you got a job with a studio, you had a job for life.
You stayed.
Yeah, and for that reason, there was very little cross-pollination between the studios.
CBS was a competitor then too, right?
This is maybe 10 years before CBS came on the scene. But if you were a BBC engineer, you did not move to Abbey Road. If you were an Abbey Road engineer, you did not move to Decca. It just was not done.
Who were the other sort of iconic, not sort of, the other iconic studios, British studios, that you researched and knew about?
Well, up until the late 60s, there were only four record labels in all of England.
Wow.
It was EMI, Decca, Philips, and Pi. And each of them, EMI had the first studio in 1931, and then Decca followed in 1956, and then the others followed afterwards. And the deal was, if you were signed to Pi, you recorded in the Pi studio. If you were signed to Decca, you recorded in the Decca studio. And there was just no moving around. It wasn't until the mid-60s that independent studios began springing up.
Wow.
Places like Olympic and AdVision and CTS.
IBC.
Exactly. Yeah.
And Air and things like that.
Air came along a little bit later. Air was 1970 when they opened.
Trident
was in 68. Okay. Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. And then the floodgates opened up. Beatlemania changed everything. They were selling millions and millions of records and making huge amounts of money, and everybody wanted to get in on the bandwagon. And by the end of the 70s, I'm sorry to interrupt, there were dozens of studios all over England by the end of the 70s. So you went from four to literally dozens, if not 100.
And the talent that came out of there, who were some of the names?
Oh, just, man.
Must be incredible.
Just staggering. In terms of the artists, you mean? Or
the engineers and producers.
Well, the engineers, I mean, you know, at Abbey Road, of course, you had George Martin, who was the head of the Parlophone record label and the Beatles producer. And all of the fabulous Beatles engineers that worked with them, Norman Smith, followed by Jeff Emmerich, followed by Ken Scott, Alan Parsons. You had amazing personnel everywhere. Decca was considered the home of great classical recording.
Yeah.
And while their engineers are not nearly as well known, most of the major classical recordings of the era were done at Decca or by Decca engineers.
Still are,
exactly.
That's amazing.
You know, talking about Air, of course, George Martin started Associated Independent Recorders. The reason he started it, go into that. This is mind-boggling.
Well, as I talk about in the book, by the end of 1963, George Martin was unquestionably the biggest recording record producer in England. His records totally dominated the charts. They'd sold literally millions and millions of copies.
He had 37 consecutive number one records and was making $4,000 a year on salary.
Correct.
Wow.
That was the nucleus of, in the beginning of.
Well, he did what any self-respecting person would do. He quit.
There you go.
And he formed his own company, AIR, with two other producers from Decca. And
that was the first independent producer that got points.
Right. He leased his services back to Abbey Road. And from 1965 on, every record that he made, not just Beatles records, was as an independent producer. And he was on points. He was the first one who set that precedent.
Wow.
That's how AIR started.
I should add that a year later, by the time AIR was cranking out records, George Martin was no longer the biggest record producer in England. He was the biggest record producer in the world.
I bet. Yeah.
That's incredible.
Not a bad group to be attached to, correct?
Right.
Were there techniques and things that were germane to studios and the culture that happened in Britain, things that sort of defined by...
Yes.
Yeah,
Well, the book begins with an exploration of the origins of the English sound mm-hmm. versus the American sound. And mm-hmm. I think that if you listen to the hit records of the 60s on both sides of the Atlantic, I think objectively you can hear that there was a difference in the sound. And there were a number of reasons why. One of them had to do with, of course, the gear.
Yeah.
The equipment was different in the English studios. Mm. Almost entirely, it was home-built.
Mm.
The consoles at EMI were red consoles built by EMI technicians. The consoles at Decca were Decca consoles built by Decca maintenance engineers.
Wow.
Did you say Decca
made their own, Pi made their own. The only one who broke the chain was Philips. Philips actually bought the first Neve console way back when. Mm. But in those days, almost everything was home-built. The one piece of equipment that was kind of common to all these studios was, we were talking earlier about the monitoring.
Mm.
Just like Altex were the standard in American studios, which usually were hung from chains and produced a lot of top-end and not a lot of bottom-end, English studios lived and died by Tannoy speakers mounted in Lockwood cabinets.
Oh, really?
And they had huge low end. And it shaped the sound of the records. Records coming out of England tended to be a lot toppier. Records coming out of America tended to have a lot more bottom end because the monitors were accentuating the opposite ends.
I'll be darned.
There was very, very little cross-pollination. If you learned to operate a console in one of these studios, you had no idea how to operate a console in a different studio.
Right.
And as I said, the engineers didn't move around anyway, so it wasn't a big problem. But there were, in addition to technical and equipment reasons, there were sociological reasons.
Hmm.
The music that the British engineers of the 60s grew up on was very different than the music that the American engineers of the 60s grew up on.
I never thought about that. That's so true.
There was a music hall tradition. There was the pub sing-song. Hmm. There was the skiffle craze. None of this reached the United States.
I was skiffling just last night. No, anyways.
What was the guy so-and-so in the Shadows? Cliff Richard in the Shadows.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And all of his big records were made at Abbey Road Studios. Yeah. So one of the most interesting themes that came out of the interviews I did for this book, and by the way, I conducted over 300 interviews for this book.
Jeez,
it took 5 years to write. It was kind of the world's longest term paper.
That's amazing, man.
But one thing that was really interesting was British engineers were constantly being asked by their clients to come up with an American drum sound, quote unquote.
Really?
Because in England, American records were seen as superior.
Oh, they were.
Well, they may or may not have been, but that was certainly the view. And what they found was they could never get an American drum sound if it was a British drummer.
Really?
It didn't have anything to do with the microphones or the placement or the processing or anything else. If there was an American drummer on the session, they'd lift up the faders and there it was instantly.
It's a cultural thing.
It was cultural, but it also came from feel.
Yeah, of course.
They made the point that the British drummers, for the most part, were trained in the military and they had real precision.
Right.
Whereas American drummers had groove and swing.
Yeah. Pocket and stuff, yeah.
And I heard these stories over and over again about how Andy Newmark or Jim Gordon or somebody would show up for a session, they'd pull up the faders and there it was, the thing that they'd been trying to achieve for years.
Wow.
Feel is everything. Oh. Let me clarify my former statement.
Uh-huh.
It's really not, from my perspective, and I put a lot of value in my perspective.
No.
It's never been either or. It's always been, it's never been better or worse. It's been either or. Like, like America held the sound in the 50s. British guys just creamed us in the early 60s. Mm-hmm. we made a couple of comebacks in the 70s, but they killed us in the 70s. Mm-hmm. Then the 80s, we started out pretty cool with mm-hmm. the Ramones, and they came back in with everything else mm-hmm. following that, and they killed us on the... It's just been kind of one or the other, and we've always idolized and tried to get their sound. It's, mm-hmm. it's interesting that they've always tried to get ours, mm-hmm. and I guess the beneficiary is the guy listening to records, because...
It's just amazing.
Well, the thing I always liked about England, I'm going to get a little bit off topic because I think it's important. The thing I liked the most about England was they had a monopoly on media, the BBC. And so in order to be accepted by the people, they had to play something for everybody. Mm-hmm. And at that time, there was just one station. So mm-hmm. that one station would play skiffle, followed by Motown, followed by classical, mm-hmm. followed by blues, followed mm-hmm. by this. So the kids in England were getting exposed to a wide variety of music, mm-hmm. whereas over here we were already starting to have specialized radio stations. Stuff, yeah. I grew up on a station that played a lot of different things, and I think that gave me an advantage. I think if you're working in music today, force yourself to listen to a lot of different stations. I recommend SiriusXM because I can go decades, I can go different types of things mm-hmm, so easily, I don't have to find it.
Absolutely.
And I think that gave England a bit of an advantage over us.
When you researched the book, what kind of genres did you see that was rock predominant and not other stuff, or did you see?
Well, there were two, in England in that era, there were really only two kinds of music. There was classical music and there was so-called pop, right. which was everything else.
Right, exactly.
In fact, at Abbey Road, you were either classified as a classical engineer or a pop engineer.
One of the two.
You didn't do both.
I'll be darned.
Norman Smith was a pop engineer. He did not do classical recording.
No crossover between those two.
No crossover whatsoever. Same as the case at Decca. Huh. Everything was kind of very rigid, very structured, and you had your job and you had your role, and it was right. very, very specialized.
Because what I notice is, to your point, there is a reverence sometimes in England about certain genres of music. I see an R&B all the time.
And blues.
And blues, certainly, where they know the artist. The artist oftentimes run out of gas here, then go there and work. Mm-hmm. They know the music. And it's just pure music. Like, it's not a political statement.
Right.
It's just stuff that they love and like and right. really celebrate. And so what I know is a lot of artists that we know love going there to work, mm-hmm. love the kind of celebration. Oftentimes they'll move there. But it's that adoration of it.
I'm sure it was the same way with you. When I was a kid, I had friends of all ethnicities that thought the blues was invented in England. Mm-hmm. They didn't realize mm-hmm. that they were copying our blues musicians. Mm-hmm. Well, not copying is the wrong word, but they were so heavily influenced by those guys. Mm-hmm. Same thing with Motown.
Mm-hmm.
Not in the sense that people thought Motown came from there, but mm-hmm. they've that ability to hear and assimilate so many different styles. Mm-hmm. I'm envious of that.
So, in your journey, because part of your background was an audio engineer and producer as well, mm-hmm. correct?
In fact, I cut my teeth in English studios.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah, I lived there in the mid-70s. I was there for a number of years. Mm-hmm. And I started out at a little demo studio in northern London called Pathway, which was just a little 8-track studio. To be honest with you, it was a little shithole of a room. It stank, uh-huh. and it was tiny. Mm-hmm. But we had a handful of good microphones.
That's where you learn, man.
And the first Elvis Costello album was cut there.
Oh, no
we
joke.
Became the darlings of the punk era.
Wow. Watching The Detectives, you did that?
I didn't do that, but it was recorded at Pathway.
Wow.
But I did a lot of the early punk stuff. I did some stuff with Joe Strummer and a number of the early punk bands. I did some work with Spandau Ballet at Pathway,
right.
Tom Stolby. But then I moved over to Trident, which was a real professional recording studio.
Let me stop you right here, because Trident is it. I mean, it stops with Trident, and it starts with Trident for me. Trident had the sound, they had the aggressiveness, they had Ken Scott, they had Roy Thomas Baker, all those Queen records. They actually signed Queen. Trident was my place.
Amazing.
Don't say anything bad about Trident.
No, I will not. I worked there.
How long were you there?
I was there for about 3 years.
Okay.
And
How did it inform your learning curve?
It's being able to sit down every day behind the Bechstein grand piano that Paul McCartney did Hey Jude on.
That was the best-sounding piano in the world, Herb.
It was
the piano that changed music. That's how amazing that piano was.
And it was the first recording studio in England that was devoted to the artist's care and the artist's comfort.
Hmm.
The founder of the studio was a fellow named Norman Sheffield, who sadly passed away a couple of years ago. He was a drummer.
Hmm.
And before there was Trident, all of the British studios were very institutional. They had glaring fluorescent lights, and there were, you know, the artist lounges were just kind of a couple little ratty chairs off in the corner.
Sure.
Norman catered to the artist's comfort beyond building a great studio.
This is the time. This is the time. Perfect time talking about how stiff they were. Tell the kick drum story. This'll freak you out.
Okay, so Jeff Emerick did his very first Beatles session at the age of 18 in April of 1966. It was the first track that they recorded for the Revolver album, a John Lennon song called Tomorrow Never Knows. And Jeff had assisted for Norman Smith for a number of years, so he knew his setup. And he began by setting up all the mics in the usual Norman Smith configuration. And this song was so out there and so totally different. And while they were kind of rehearsing and working through it, Jeff heard in his head a different kind of drum sound. He thought it needed a more immediate, in-your-face kind of sound. Mm-hmm. So he was 18, he was a kid, he'd been there for a few years, but he kind of didn't know the rules well enough. And so he was perfectly willing to break them. I mean, he just, because he didn't know. Mm-hmm. The sound he heard in his head, he wanted the kick drum to be right in your face. So first thing he did was he looked around the room for something to stuff inside Ringo's bass drum, to muffle it, which had never been done before. Mm-hmm. Any of you out there who ever saw the Beatles movie Help, it was originally named Eight Arms to Hold You, and they had a promotional sweater with eight arms. And that was sitting on top of one of the road cases, and Jeff grabbed it and he stuffed it inside the kick drum, and a little bit better.
Voila.
But then he moved the microphone on the kick drum right inside. So it was like six inches away. Completely illegal.
No joke.
But it gave him the sound he wanted. And a few days later, he got a letter from the EMI studio management telling him that what he had done was in direct contravention of the rules.
Oh, my God.
And that he only had special dispensation to do it in future on Beatles session.
Is that
he had
right?
to sign a letter saying, I agree, I will only ever do this on Beatles sessions.
That's the environment that Trident came up
into. That's amazing.
Right. And, of course, at Abbey Road, the engineers had to wear jackets and ties, and the maintenance engineers had to wear white lab coats. Wow. And the maintenance engineers had to wear brown lab coats. At Trident, everybody was dressed in orange flowery shirts, and you know, it was, and people were smoking dope in the lounge, and everybody was like perfectly comfortable. And
the music
happy.
Sounded that way too.
It really
was
helped.
Just rebellious.
Yeah,
and that's why the Beatles made one of their occasional forays outside of Abbey Road, and they did Hey Jude at Trident. It was their first 8-track recording.
Huh. Now I'm going to listen to that differently. A little weed.
Can I tell that? Oh, I love this. I love Trident. So Trident actually signed Queen to a record deal, and Freddie Mercury and the ownership didn't get along. So Death on Two Legs is about him trying to get rid of the label, which was on, which album was that on?
I don't remember which album. Yeah, I know the song.
The first album, second album. Okay. Had to be the second album because he left. But so the early Queen records, Tie Your Mother Down and all that stuff was done at Trident. When I heard Tie Your Mother Down, it was like a film had been lifted off my face and I could see clearer.
And years later, Norman Sheffield wrote a memoir that he was the founder of Trident, and he titled it Life on Two Legs.
Oh, really? Oh, how cool is that?
It was kind of a little bit of a swipe back.
But. So now, when did you start your authoring career, your writer's career?
I'm guessing it was sometime in the mid-80s, I'm thinking. I mean, my entire career has been a series of left turns. I started out wanting to be a rock and roll star.
And
I moved to England to be a rock and roll star and didn't quite get there, but I did spend many years on the road as a touring musician.
What do you play?
I started as a drummer and I moved to bass, so I'm more of a bass player.
Okay.
And we had the classic band story. We were fighting and scraping our way up the London club circuit. And we finally landed a gig as a headliner at the Marquee Club, which is the most famous, biggest club. And we broke up that night.
Oh, really?
I have no idea why. I couldn't tell you to this day. But as a direct result of that, we were seen there by a major publisher, and I was the songwriter in the band, so he offered me a songwriting deal. And in those days, there were no home studios. There was no home recording equipment. So I had to do my demos at studios in town. And that's where I kind of learned the craft of being a recording engineer.
And you had to use live musicians.
Exactly. Yeah. And I was eventually offered a job at this demo studio that I told you about, Pathway, as one of their recording engineers. And as it so happened, the very first record I mixed, the very first session, was a top 20 hit. Completely despite me, not because of me, I can assure you. I had no idea what I was doing. But it, and then I was all of a sudden an in-demand American engineer living in London.
I'll be done.
Moved from that to production, and then I came back to New York and worked for several years at Electric Lady Studios in the Village. And this was around the time synthesizers started coming out. I'd had a modular Moog, and I was familiar with that. And then the Yamaha DX7 came around. And I kind of went into a room and wrestled with it for a few months because nobody had any idea how it worked. And I more or less figured it out for myself. And then somebody said to me, you should write a book about that. So I did. And now all of a sudden, I'm an author.
Exactly. Absolutely. So in the, in this range of books, this wide range of books, I know there was another one that we were battling over here, which is called Roadie.
Oh, that's my newest one. Right? My first novel.
Right. So it's fiction, but it's based on some compelling things.
I can tell you the most outrageous stories, and they are completely true.
Okay.
The names were changed to protect the innocent.
Oh, I can't wait.
Give us an example of the most one of the most outrageous.
There is a scene that takes place in an Amsterdam sex club.
I was there.
I was there.
Oh, you were there.
I was there.
I saw you.
Yeah, I remember catching you out of the corner of my eye. And it basically involves eating a space cake, getting the most extreme case of munchies known to man, wandering around Amsterdam in the middle of the night in search of food, and stumbling into this room at the Milky Way, which was a very famous nightclub.
Wow.
And all I could see when I went through the door was this buffet. And I started frantically stuffing myself with food. It's disgusting. And it was only after I was kind of halfway through eating this that I realized I was the only person in the room who wasn't naked. And there was actually a sex show going on.
You're kidding.
Now, the version in Roadie is considerably exaggerated from what actually happened, but it happened. It happened, trust me.
Is Roadie a little bit about an existing real person?
Roadie was inspired by the life of Ian Stewart. Stu, he was the co-founder of the Rolling Stones with Brian Jones, and a great piano player and a lovely guy who everybody liked, but he didn't fit the image. He looked a bit like Jay Leno. And just on the eve of the Stones' first release, just on 2 weeks before their success, he was fired by the band's manager because he, quote unquote, didn't look like a rock star.
Oh my God.
And instead, they offered him a job as their roadie. And to my amazement, he took it. Yeah. And he spent the next 30 years hauling their equipment on stage and never wrote a book. He died suddenly and unexpectedly in 1985. Wow. And I used to wonder what must have been going through his mind.
Oh, my God.
Sitting on the side of the stage watching this band that he started reach this unparalleled success. And he's bringing the amps up there and plugging things in. He played piano on a few songs, the songs that he liked. But he wouldn't.
Yeah. He's like the Pete Best of the Stones.
Except that Pete Best was fired because he was a crappy drummer. Stu was a really good piano player. It was all about the way he looked, nothing else. So that inspired me, and I thought, well, I'll never know what was going through his mind, but let me invent a character similar, somebody who starts a band and is the catalyst and gets fired just before their success because of his looks. And then I created my own universe. I mean, after 20 years of writing nonfiction where everything is about the truth and you have to get things right.
Yeah.
It's so creatively freeing to write a novel where you're God.
Yeah, right.
And if you don't like a character, you can kill him off brutally. Right away. It's great. It's absolutely. Very cathartic.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So, of the 16 novels, most on audio, most in the music space?
Yeah, all of them have been, except one. I co-authored a book about retirement planning.
Okay.
But I guess my...
Seems like a non sequitur.
It was a little odd, but I was approached by somebody who needed a co-author, and it was interesting. It was an interesting project, but it had nothing to do with the music business. Everything else has been, you know, they say write about what you know, and this is the industry I know.
Behind the Glass.
Thank you.
That's a great series.
It was a collection of interviews, right?
Yeah, we have some of his books in the audio library we have here.
And it was in the first Behind the Glass that I first interviewed George Martin.
Oh, really?
Which was wow. I actually spent an entire day with him, which was just
how many of your books did you do with Hal Leonard?
A half dozen of them, I think.
Oh, cool.
Yeah,
the best Behind ones, the Glass. Right?
The best ones, of course.
Except for this one.
Except for Roadie, and the only reason we did offer it to Hal Leonard, but at this current time, they don't do fiction.
Right.
So we went with another press in New York, yep. But hopefully future work.
We'll get it together. Chongor, you got some questions over in the guest office? Yep. What you got?
This first one's from Sam Boydell. Do you think a studio that we're going to business today has the same ability to create a legacy as studios of the past?
Sure, why not?
Yeah.
Why not? There's absolutely no reason why not.
There's no limitations.
There's no limitations if you've got the right setup and the right gear and the right people. You know, it's down to the nut behind the wheel, always.
And that's the dynamic to all success, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, right? Don't you think?
It's about the people. And I mean, the Great British Recording Studio is a book about facilities. Mm-hmm. But in every facility, I wanted to emphasize early on the key personnel because it was about
the
people.
That's what the book's really about.
Yeah.
Right, right.
Some really great.
It always boils down to that. Chongor, you got another one?
Yep, from Tim Brown. In all of the research you did for the Great British Recording Studios, what piece of information blew you away the most?
The fact that these guys were flying by the seat of their pants most of the time. Mm-hmm. The fact that they really didn't know what they were doing a lot of the time. The fact that they kind of blindly stumbled into winning formulas.
Right.
And I kind of had that sense when I was living in England, but I never really knew it this firmly or this concretely until I got to interview all of these guys. You kind of always had the facility, the sense in a British facility that it wasn't quite completely professional. There were always kind of little blemishes and flaws. It wasn't like visiting a record plant where, you know, it's finely tuned machinery and everything works.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you think right now we're entering into a bit of a period like that, the digital revolution? We're still trying to figure it out. We're still trying to make it work and make it musical. And I wonder if 40 years from now we'll be looking at this time period similar to that time period, because it is in turmoil, and it is heading towards the home smaller studios that are going to ultimately one day become the big studios. It has kind of a certain parallel feel, don't you think?
Yeah, I wouldn't disagree. I do think there are a couple of key differences, though. I mean, back in the 60s, there really wasn't this kind of backlog of quality or great work to kind of use as a yardstick, where today you're sort of, a lot of people are measuring what they're doing versus records that were made
in the
60s.
But isn't that the big impediment to the digital revolution?
It may well be, but it's a difference.
Because when you try to stay that tethered to the past, it's hard to move into the future.
Mm-hmm. You're right. Mm-hmm. And the other difference is that the 60s and 70s were a time of economic explosion in the music business. Right. Yeah. The Beatles paved the way, and everybody
unlimited budgets. Yeah.
And
then
today, there's no budgets and no money, and you're really fighting a much,
a big
much bigger battle.
Big difference.
Whole different world. Now, young, kind sir, I noticed that you've been in the gym and losing weight, doing stuff, getting ready for our live series.
I got some aluminum weights. They're lighter.
Oh, cool. There you go. It's like, and he's got an aluminum bat, which means he can swing it faster. So you ready for batter's box, sir?
I am so ready.
All right, let's tee it up, and let's have a drum roll. Okay. And first pitch.
Okay, I'm going to have to set this up. Okay. I'm going to name a studio from England in the past, and he's going to tell us the most famous or one of the most famous artists that did a record in that studio.
All right, here we go.
We go fast, man.
All right,
go fast.
Here we go.
Abbey Road.
Beatles.
Boom.
Trident.
David Bowie.
Ooh.
Olympic.
Rolling Stones.
Ooh. AdVision.
Yes.
The Mobile Rolling Stones Unit.
Led Zeppelin.
Decca.
Moody Blues. Mm.
IBC, my favorite.
The Who. Mm.
Phillips and Pye.
Well, Phillips would be Dusty Springfield, and Pye would be the Kinks. Mm.
Okay, my favorite. Holloway. This is a trick question.
304 Holloway Road, Joe Meek's studio. That was Telstar.
Damn.
I would have said Lola by the Kinks, but that's
Lola
just me.
Was done at Pye.
Wessex.
Wessex Sex Pistols.
Watch this. Okay.
Apple. No Apples, Beatles, no
Apple's
Beatles.
Apple's a tough one. Steeler's Wheel, Stuck in the Middle with You.
Ooh.
He's good, Herb. He's good.
Shit. He made me cuss. I've never cussed at Batter's Box before.
I missed my note on Pie, but Lola was Pie.
No, you did a good job. There's no shame
Holloway,
in your game.
Holloway was what's his name, came up with a compressor that I like so much.
The Joe Meek compressor, absolutely.
He's written 16 books. Your pitches were blazing. I'm impressed. Maybe one of your best Batter's Boxes, but boy, he had an aluminum bat.
No,
it was just going out over the fence.
I can see it.
It's a fix.
So, you've got all this catalog of work. More books in the future? What are you looking at? What interests you?
I'm actually looking to transition and become a novelist.
Oh, there you go.
I just had so much
so
fun
this
writing
being
Brody.
The non, yeah. Yeah, nonfiction.
I'm
yeah.
about two-thirds of my way through my next novel.
Fiction.
This
yeah,
is
yeah.
fiction.
Yeah, yeah.
Next one is called Stand Up. It's about an extremely successful and famous stand-up comedian who really is inept
oh, cool.
at his heart.
Cool. As you have seen the various stuff that you've seen over 16 years, I think it's a compendium kind of on the business, on the ebb and flow of the business mm-hmm. and how it's come and gone. Are you hopeful? Are you optimistic?
Sure. I'm always hopeful. I mean, there's always great talent, and there's always great music, and yeah. there's always great innovations, and the technology is advancing at leaps and bounds these days. Mm-hmm. Totally hopeful. There's no reason to think that the artistic results won't keep exceeding. The problem now is... there's so much bandwidth, it's kind of hard to fight your way through it, and there's so little money to work with.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm sure solutions are going to get found.
And I think, well, I'm curious to see what you think. Dave and I talk about this a lot. Sometimes you have to remeasure success.
Yes.
So if it's not about the big budget and you're doing Imagine Dragons, it might be you're the audio chief of the forensic unit, mm-hmm. or you're the audio guy who's doing something else. Because these are now transferable skills and people have the technology. So what we see from our chair, because we think education is really important, but you have to educate yourself not in a linear box, kind of you got to think this way.
Absolutely.
Right? And then you can bring that back home to other and newer things. Digital technology,
any profession,
media.
You have to do that now.
Yeah, I think so.
I think it's universal.
To me, success is about being able to do what you love.
Absolutely.
Whether you can make a living at it or not is a separate issue. There's plenty of people who do boring jobs that are making great art in their spare time.
Right, right.
And, you know, to that extent, I feel absolutely blessed. I mean, I've built a career of being able to do what I love.
We're talking about three lucky stiffs right here doing
totally.
What we're doing, and we're still doing what we're doing. See, the reason why this show is important, I'm really glad we did it, is contextually, when you see people who have literally chronicled the past, but the past is prologue sometimes, you get a chance to go through these things and go, oh, wow, I can learn from this. Here's stuff where you literally can go in and find the kind of specificity that he comes up with as an author from his experience level and then apply it to what you do and reinvent and come up with new things. Like sometimes the past is exactly what you need to borrow from to get to the future. Would you agree?
You need to know your roots. You need to know where you came from in order to get where you want to go.
And not just as a history lesson, not just as an old
Absolutely.
Folks thing. You know, old Absolutely. Folks say, you need to know your past, young man. Sometimes it's about, let me go get that foundation, and now let me go do something with it that's new. You actually can take the foundation with the technology and do something new.
And one of my favorite quotes, and I don't know where this came from, and maybe somebody out there can tell us, which I've used repeatedly, I've probably overused, there's two kinds of fools. One says, this is old and therefore good.
Mm-hmm.
The other says, this is new and therefore better.
Ah, you know, that came from Chong Gorgon's.
Yeah,
okay.
That came from
could
me.
Well have been.
<David
Chong. laughs> Absolutely. Howard, we couldn't thank you more.
Yeah.
I'm glad you did it. The
My
work
pleasure.
You've done, we've got a bunch of your work in our audio library back there, and it is. We're now fledgling authors, and we're signing some folks, and we know how disciplined you have to be and how thorough you have to be to get this stuff correct. I can tell you, I'm holding the Great British Recording Studios book. Malcolm Atkin, who's the chair of the Association of Professional Recording Services, said, one of the most important books ever written about recording, a treasure trove of information about the British studio scene during the most explosive period of growth. When somebody says you got the most important book ever written, you've done really good work.
Thank
and there's
you,
16
man.
Of those things, correct?
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. And the new one. Rhodey, you gotta do it. DP, take us home, man.
I'm gonna punt this one to Howard.
Okay.
Explain to me, WTF, the British tea boy at the studio. What was his job? How's he doing? Is it obsolete? Is he...
They still drink tea in England, so it's not obsolete.
There you go.
The tea boy's job was, tea boy is the equivalent to the runner over here in the States. But his primary job was to make the tea because everybody's gobbling this down in horrendous quantities all the time.
So he's not extinct. He's doing okay.
Well, they're still drinking tea in England, last time I looked. And I'm heading there next week, so I'll confirm it for
Let
you.
Let us know. And maybe what we'll do for this year's Pensado Awards is change it from the Air Awards to the AIRT Award,
which
is Best Assistant, Intern, Runner, and T-Boy.
I like it.
How
like
we
it.
Do that?
I like
Say
it.
Say goodbye.
I always wanted to be a T-Boy.
You are one.
I don't know what else to say other than Abbey Road, they invented the direct box there. What else you got to say? All right, guys, next week.
See ya.